As Ecuador lies right on the equator, things get dark at almost exactly 6 p.m. each night. And night is a wonderful time to get out shooting macros. Not only is it a lot cooler and more comfortable, there's a lot of unique invertebrates that are nocturnal or more active at night. And in the cloud forests of Ecuador, there exists an amazing diversity of these apilionids, or harvestmen. These leggy arachnids are in their own order, they're not spiders, and they're often overlooked and misunderstood. And some of these armored crinaid harvestmen are sexually dimorphic, with larger males having prominent posterior spines and spiny legs for combat with other males. And despite looking kind of scary, these animals are completely harmless to humans. Not only do they not produce venom, they're incapable of it, they're beneficial scavengers and predators. These guys are a relatively common sight on leaves at night, just standing there with their first and second pair of legs raised out into the air. And a rear view of this species kind of looks like a funny little face. I can imagine a man with a big nose and a little hat. Here, the pupae of a parasitic fly line the top of this harvestman. And he's got it pretty light too. I saw other harvestmen almost completely covered. And I think the little white bits on this harvestman are actually mites. During one of the nighttime frog walks in a creek, our guide carefully fished this huge tarantula out of her burrow. One of many highlights of this night walk in the creek was this beautiful velvety golden spider. I'm not familiar with this eye arrangement, but I think he might be a ghost spider of some sort. Nearby, I found this similar looking but less golden female. We did find a few frogs as well, including this handsome emerald glass frog, which might be a male, judging from the presence of those humeral hooks you see there on the legs. Although my trip was during a bugshot macro photography workshop, I wasn't acting as an instructor this time. I was just tagging along as I couldn't pass up the opportunity of visiting Ecuador. And I really hope I can make it back here someday. This was truly one of the most beautiful and rich places I've ever visited. And although I of course love working with others in the field and talking macro, this was a unique opportunity for me to really take my time and focus on shooting macros alone and soak in the environment. There were birding tours and other tempting side trips during my time near Mendo, but I opted to stay put for the most part and was ultimately glad I did. I was only there for a week, but focusing on the same nearby trails day after day gave me a chance to really observe what these forests have to offer at a slower and more comfortable pace for me, and to see what pops up in the same areas at different times of day. Often I didn't have to wander far into the forest at all, in an area so abundant with life, just crouching in one spot revealed all sorts of things I may not have otherwise noticed. Most often, spiders are on my mind when wandering a new area. There's always the hope of big fancy jumping spiders, or maybe here a wandering spider. But it's not always easy finding spiders. You don't always see them. I know there's collection methods out there that would increase the amount of spiders I could find, like a beading sheet, for example, but I don't really want to go around beating on plants and shaking them up just for spiders, and even if I did this gently, it would disturb what I'm looking for. I'd like to see and record these animals as found. That said, if someone brings me a spider in a vial, I definitely won't turn it down. I'll just try and make sure it gets released again where it was found. So, where are all the salticid photos? I actually only found a few jumpers, including this translucent green Lissomanes species female. She's a very unique, mostly hairless salticid with an atypical eye arrangement. Also note that little mite walking underneath her. I often carry little vials with me to let jumping spiders hop into if I'd like to shoot them in a more controlled environment, really to make sure I can get diagnostically useful angles before releasing them again. A clean dorsal view, any standout characters, and a nice portrait, of course. But I really didn't do any of that on this trip. Increasingly more, I feel conflicted about removing animals from their habitat, even if just briefly. I'm not an arachnologist, and I don't collect specimens in any formal manner. At least on this trip, I was happy just to take it easy and not get quite so hung up on getting a perfect shot. Just shooting things in the field, and if they get away, they get away, and let them go on with their little lives. There's a lot of different ways animals try to camouflage themselves or look like a part of their environment. And the walking sticks, or phasmids, often try to look like sticks, and in some areas even leaves. Sometimes I'll think I've found some amazingly camouflaged insect, and then upon a closer look, realize it was actually just a stick. And I only noticed this walking stick after doing a double take. Very cool and cryptic, with that weird curled up abdomen and little thorny spines. And I don't know if it's what this lizard was going for exactly, but this little sleeping dude looked just like the brown, fallen, decomposing leaves around him. One of the more daunting groups of insects for me to learn has been the flies. There's just so many of them and so many families I'm not familiar with. Flies as well try to look like things they aren't. This micropesid fly is dancing around its white-socked forelegs to mimic the antenna of a wasp. These flies have an interesting mating posture, with the male's front legs resting on her antenna, middle legs clamped down behind her head, and rear legs just up in the air. Although not a stock-eyed fly, this male Richardia species hammerhead fly has also independently evolved extra wide eyes. Apparently, the male initially emerges with normal eyes and then hydraulically pushes his eyes and head outwards to impress females or combat other males. I don't know exactly, but they're beautiful flies. Of course, a lot of amazing lepidopterans are found too, including these cool Pantherotes moths hanging out down in a creek. I love that splotchy, stained look of those markings. Now this caterpillar, which I still haven't identified, took me by surprise a bit with its saturated red head, white lateral tufts, and mottled red spots. I get that this is probably warning coloration, aposematic coloration, but what a weird, unique method. I could get lost in those red spots set against deep, penetrating black. And what about this weirdo? Why would you want to look like a hot yellow bit of hair or a feather? And this shag carpet caterpillar may be trying to look like it's been parasitized with those white tufts, kind of looking like wasp larva. Some moths, despite being cryptic, were easy to spot out in the open. Like this interesting moth found on a broad leaf with its wings up. I suspect it may be a bombycid with the abdomen curled up like that. There's a certain understated beauty to these leaf-mimicking moths. Naturally, a cluster of people quickly gathered around this absolutely massive Saturnian moth, easily one of the biggest moths I've ever seen, approaching a good 6 inches or so wingspan, easy to shoot with the 15mm wide-angle macro. Speaking of big leps, I was excited to see this huge Caligo owl butterfly, which I'd never seen in the wild before. Aside from the obvious owl eye markings, I was surprised to notice they also have a pretty convincing snakehead wingtip. In retrospect, I kind of wish I'd also taken a low-angle portrait of this little metal mark moth, but oh well. I came across this beautiful blue tiger moth one morning on the trail, and it was a great start to the day. Whenever I see such vivid colors like this, I have to wonder how other insects or spiders see them, as I know not all animals see the same wavelengths that we do. Here's another similar moth, but with slightly malformed wings. I'm guessing this happened as it was emerging and still soft. A handsome yellow geometrid with little metallic rusty scales shining back. The gap and the scales of this moth's wings kind of look like a little bald man wearing sunglasses to me. Maybe one of my favorite moths spotted on this trip was this Pakidota Nervosa with its wing venation lined with black scales. I fully admit to often passing up ants when shooting in the field. They're just too fast for me to focus on sometimes, but when in a new area, I feel a compulsion to at least try. And in the case of this ant I found wandering on a leaf one morning, the effort paid off. Deeply grooved like a fingerprint, Even the petiole of this ant has a little whirl. I chased the ant around the leaf for a while, but when she passed through this hole to evade me, I let her go and moved on. Here's a view from below, looking straight up into a Polistes paper wasp nest, so you can see the young. It kind of took an awkward contortion on my part to squat underneath the nest and aim the camera straight up. Those larvae are pretty cute, swaddled in their little papery cells. I initially thought this ant might have been a Cephalotes species turtle ant, but it's a different type of armored arboreal gliding ant, Procryptoceras. I was a bit hesitant when Alex Wild asked if I wanted to be bitten by this army ant, though the bite is really just to stabilize for a sting, which is mild and tingling. More interesting to me were these weird ghostly eyes lacking omatidia, apparently re-evolved from blind underground ancestors. There are some animals I've always dreamt of seeing, but never truly believed I would get the chance to see. And onychophorans, or velvet worms, were one of those animals. So, I was almost in disbelief when I heard that one had been found in a log during a night walk. These animals belong to their own ancient phylum, Onychophora, and despite the common name, they aren't worms. They're more closely related to arthropods and tardigrades, although having branched off long ago. It was wild to watch it move with so many sets of stubby little legs, its cylindrical body elongating out to a great length when moving in a straight line. I felt an obligation to handle it with great care, not just because of how rare and special it seemed to me, but because they have the ability to squirt a glue-like substance defensively, and I figured it might be expensive for it to produce. It was really a privilege to be able to see, let alone shoot the velvet worm, and in my excitement, I forgot to shoot video of it. All the more reason to maybe visit Ecuador again someday. In conclusion, my time in Ecuador was a really humbling one, a reminder of how little I truly know and how much more I've yet to learn. No matter how much I think I've learned about macro or entomology or biology in general, I really don't know much at all. Like the best experiences, it's still the deep desire to learn more, and I'm really grateful for the opportunity to have visited such a diverse and beautiful place.